Respira. It means to sigh. I'm going to ask for a prayer now. And, you know, I don't think we're going to be on the time schedule. So please bear with me. But you know what? We're going to be... We're not worried about time, but the second meeting may not start at 2. All right, so I'm just going to say, ask for a blessing. Loving Father, in all seriousness, we are living in very solemn times. I pray that you will bless me, take my body, my mind, my heart, my voice, and use it for your glory. May you speak through me. Just use me as a vessel. May I decrease, may Danny disappear as it were and let you appear. Father, I just really ask that you speak your message for this hour, that we're all prepared for what's ready to happen on this earth. And I pray for this anointing, for the baptism of thy Holy Spirit. Fill me, may I be a partaker of thy divine nature. And thank you, Lord, for the promise that all things whatsoever we shall ask in prayer, believing, we shall receive. In Jesus' name, amen. Wow. Well, here we go. Oh, you know who I am? I'm Danny Vierra from Modern Manna Ministries in Lodi, California. People are coming in and saying, I've seen you on YouTube, and I was on Amazing Facts Television for 3ABN and all these different things. I've been doing this a long time. Ralph and I announced last night we've been doing it together, or on and off, for what, 30 years we've known each other? 30 years! He knew me when I wasn't even Adventist. I think he was a Sabbath school teacher for the youth, and he said, why don't you come? And, you know, and we gradually became best friends and started sharing the message. What I bring to you today is a message and a weekend of health and fitness and natural remedies and raw food cooking. But my bigger message is about preparation. We're living in some pretty solemn times right now. And I've been traveling the world. I've been doing a lot of studying. And I've been looking at these signs of the times. You heard of the blood moons, right? That's a big one right now that evangelical pastor John Hagee, Mark Biltz, that they even came out with the movie recently, the Tetrad, four blood moons in succession when they fall on Jewish feast days, that something significant is supposed to happen. And I want to keep that wide open. I'm not pinpointing any dates, but I'm going to tell you current events and what people are saying right now, because all types of signs are pointing to September this year. And I just want to share some things because I think it's interesting to watch. And I think we all in this room realize that something's ready to happen, right? So you have the Tetrad, you have the four blood moons, three have been fulfilled, the fourth is coming, and it lands on a Jewish feast day, therefore they feel that something significant is going to happen. Then you have Jonathan Cahn. He's a Jewish speaker, very powerful speaker. He did one of these prayer breakfasts, and he really hit the sins of America and the judgments of God falling on our country, that if we do not repent from all our immorality, that judgments are going to fall. And he wrote a book, The Harbinger. And now he's talking about the Shemitah. Even my pastor, Seventh-day Adventist pastor, gave a sermon a few weeks ago on the Shemitah. The Shemitah is a seven-year period called the Sabbath of rest, where every 7 years the land would rest. It would go back to the original owners. All debts were canceled, and there was a great blessing. But if the nation of Israel was in apostasy, or they were not following God's appointed ways, there was great judgment. So he alludes to 2000. What followed was 2001, 9/11. 7 years later, he takes you up to 2007, and what followed, the year of the Shemitah, was the stock market crash and the big financial crisis that hit the United States. So the projections now, 2014, as we're in this Shemitah year, something's going to happen. Then you have the Pope of Rome coming to address Congress in September. And you look at all these, and my wife said, yeah, and there's an asteroid that may hit the Earth in September. And so, whatever, I'm watching. I don't think I'd be invested in the stock market, personally. We all sense something stupendous is coming, a terrorist attack. But the thing that alarms me is I looked at even Jade Helm 2015. Have you heard of Jade Helm 15? Where the military with the Green Berets and the Navy SEALs, they're all going to converge on seven states in the United States for military exercises. And they're going to be in civilian clothing. You may not know who they are. But there is some big movements happening right now with military vehicles in the United States. There's videos I've been watching of hundreds of military vehicles in Southern California. So Jade Helm 15, the Texas governor's concerned, and the state police are going to watch, and it's going to converge on the hot spots. The red zones is Texas, Utah, and Southern California. So I'm watching. What's going to happen? We all know something's going to happen. Jesus is going to come. This thing's going to end under some president of the United States. And what we're watching now with the immoral, the homosexuality, what's being pressed upon our youth, our children, we're seeing immorality and the degraded morals of society like never before, right? So you got blood moons, you got the Shemitah, you got the Pope coming to address Congress, you got an asteroid, you got Jade Helm 15. You're seeing everything in place. I mean, I watched a video the other day by Bob Treves, and he was talking about detention facilities in the United States, and they're showing these tents, these big white tents being erected everywhere, and for checkpoints on the roads, 3,200 buildings have been erected and sold and going to be ready to be put into place for checkpoints along your roads. What's ready to happen? Why is the military preparing? Why all the armed vehicles in the United States? Is something stupendous ready to happen? I would say yes. I'm not going to say when, the date, but everybody's pointing to September, just so you know. Fair enough? So I just covered some span of history of current events for you. And it's not to alarm you. What it's supposed to do is to motivate you to get in the best physical and spiritual condition of your life. That's what I want to accomplish this weekend with all the things that are happening. So one of my favorite books is the book of Daniel. Now in chapter 1, Verse 1, it says, in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, into Jerusalem, and he besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with part of the vessels of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar, to the house of his God. And he brought the vessels into the treasure house of his God. And then the king spoke unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel unto the king's seat and of the princes, children in whom was no blemish. Now, I want to stop there a minute. When I'm studying the book of Daniel, I look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2, that we can learn from the past. That as we looked, as God was miraculously leading his children through the wilderness, the Bible says that he provided spiritual meat and drink. What's spiritual meat and drink? Well, we know the story of the manna. We know how he smote the rock and the water came out. So miraculously, God provided for his people, okay, as they wandered through the wilderness 40 years. So God will provide for his people. Here we look as we have the story of the children of Israel being taken captive by the king of Babylon, right? And here they're bringing these children of Israel out and they pull out four out of the crowd. We know the story, Daniel. Hananiah, Azariah, Mishael. And I look, what was different about those four that they grabbed them? I think they were physical fitness buffs. I think, you know, there was something unique about them, but the Bible uses this depiction, children in whom was no blemish. Now that's key, because as we look into the New Testament, we see this scriptures in Ephesians 5, 25 through 27, that Christ also loved the church. Okay, so the category here is the church. He loved the church. He gave himself for it that he might sanctify. And that word means to make holy. Okay, and cleanse it by the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So as I look at this scripture, I see that Daniel, to me, as from my readings, is an example of the church held captive in Babylon and the spiritual condition of the church that's held captive in Babylon. So can this be a story, an example, a lesson for us living in the last days, especially when it's ready to converge and take us captive? So he was skillful in wisdom, cunning in knowledge, understanding science, such as the ability in them to stand in the king's palace, whom he might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. So he saw they were special. They were kind of an elite group. The Bible refers to them as children with no blemish. We saw the illustration here in the New Testament that God is wanting the same condition of his people in the last days. Fair? Agreed? All right. So he was skilled in knowledge, understanding science. Let us make man in our image after our likeness, and therefore let us glorify God in our body and in your spirit. I believe he understood science. God had given dietary law. God had given instruction on the foods for the Israelites to eat and not to eat. I believe Daniel was bright. I believe he was in shape. I believe he was very intelligent. Now let's follow this story a minute and see how we can apply it to our own lives in these last days. He refused the king's meat and wine. That's important to know. The Bible says that Daniel purposed in his heart. You know, I want to pause there. I like those words. He purposed in his heart. You know, where is God in the new covenant putting his law? In your mind and in your heart. And so I believe he knew what was right. And I'm going to show you this today, that he was brought up knowing God's laws and principles, his statutes, his judgments. And so Daniel, in his heart, says, wait a minute, I would be violating God's laws. I will not do that. It also means he said no. He would not defile himself with a portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. The Torah or the Pentateuch or the scrolls of the prophets. We know these are the books that Moses wrote, right? And Daniel had access to this information. And this statement in a book I like called Fundamentals of Christian Education says, Daniel searched the portion of the Old Testament which he had at his command, and he made the word of God his highest instructor. Now, are you following me? As I move along in the end of time, this has great impact on my life and my research. This needs to be your highest instructor. Okay? Bottom line, we need to be in the Word of God like never before. I can spend so much time listening to Mark Biltz and John Hagee or Jonathan Kahn that I'm not in the Scriptures. See, I want to be into the prophecies. I want to be studying the life of Christ. I want to be at the gym exercising and keeping my body temple in the best condition as possible, because something's coming. And my message today is so vital, because many of us sitting here today are not prepared for what's ready to hit. We can talk about it. We've been talking about this type of stuff for how many years, Ralph? But we're not ready. We're not even exercising. Daniel and his associates had been trained by their parents to habits of strict temperance. They had been taught that God would hold them accountable for their capabilities, that they must never dwarf or enfeeble their powers. This education was to Daniel and his companions the means of their preservation amidst the demoralizing influences of the courts of Babylon. Are you seeing demoralizing influences in the United States of America? Same-sex marriage. The Supreme Court ready to rule on it. Everything's changing fast, isn't it? I mean, everywhere I go, I mean, tattoos cover the body. Everything's pierced. The hair's different colors. And I'm seeing this degradation, this demoralizing influence around my children today. Strong were the temptations surrounding them and that corrupt and luxurious court, but they remained uncontaminated. No power, no influence could sway them from the principles they had learned early in life by a study of the word and the works of God. So why did Daniel refuse the king's wine? Now think, he knew the Torah, he knew the Pentateuch, he knew the Old Testament books. And watch what this says. They dare not risk the enervating effect. Enervated means fatigue, run down, lack of energy. So alcohol is going to cause a benumbing of your mind. It's going to affect the clarity of your mind, how your mind thinks, functions. The effect of luxury dissipation on the physical, mental, and spiritual development. Did you get this? Physical, mental, and spiritual development. They were acquainted with the history of Nadab and Abihu. There it is, the Old Testament stories. The record of whose intemperance and its results had been preserved in the parchments of the Pentateuch, and they knew that their own physical and mental power would be injuriously affected by the use of wine. So the history of Israel was studied. The story of Nadab and Abihu was told and retold. The effect of strong drink was impressed on the mind of this teenage Hebrew. The laws of his being were studied. He knew that intemperate eating and drinking would so dull the mind that the voice of God could not be heard. See, right now in this day and age, I realize that we're living in the last remnant of time. I also realize that the devil is going about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. I do realize in Luke 21 that Jesus Christ prophesied, beware of surfeiting and drunkenness and the cares of the life in these last days, for as a snare shall it come upon all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. So the devil's using intemperance. Surfeiting is overindulgence, an overabundance of food. Drunkenness is an overabundance of alcohol. So he's throwing alcohol, he's throwing food, and he's trying to lure us, just as he used food at the Garden of Eden, to tempt. And he knows that if we partake to these excesses of these foods, we're going to impair the clarity of our mind and our moral judgment and hearing the voice of God. Because the only medium which God communicates with man and affects his inmost being is through the delicate nerves of the brain. So the devil's attack is on the nervous system. The devil's attack is on your brain. Daniel would not take alcohol. It would dull his mind. He would not hear the voice of God. So do not drink wine nor strong drink. Do not drink wine nor strong drink. You, your sons with thee, that you may put difference between holy and unholy. When I hear today that people within my own church are now drinking wine, I said, what? I have a right to say this because I was an alcoholic. I have a right to say this because I was so drunk every Friday night, every Saturday night that I'd roll cars, I'd get in wrecks, I'd end in the back of a police car. My brother had a girl killed in his car, 12 kids, one girl. She dies in his car because he's inebriated. Intoxication. I am not going to let anything in my body that's going to affect the clarity of my mind, especially in this day and age. Why do you want to play with it? It's good for your heart. So is grape juice. Does it have to rot? Do the grapes have to rot before you want to believe that it's healthier for you? You do not want to let anything interfere with the clarity of your mind. You need the clearest mind possible. Not only abstain from alcohol, but step up the daily exercise, because perfect health depends on perfect circulation. So notice, holy, and that you may teach the children of Israel all the statutes which the Lord has spoken unto them by the hand of Moses. So look at this powerful statement from Daniel and the prophet by S.N. Haskell. It was an age when the young men in Judah were wild and reckless. They were excusing themselves because of their youth. But God chose certain ones whom he could trust. Pure food, clean thoughts. Wow. Physical exercise. Isn't that beautiful? Exercise, good food, clean thoughts. I'm going to tell you a true story. Last week, we had an issue happen that was terrible. Attempted suicide. Somebody's beat up, raped, and then attempt suicide, and then the father of her daughters picked up for murder. Just hit me. I'm off the plane in from Fiji. Boom, 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 pow. And here's the nose rings, and here's the hair, and here's the tattoos, and here's the wayward life, and we're trying to help the individual. But I believe that we have to also be careful, because I call them portals, whereby the devil gets into your house. Portals of entry. So that night, and we're trying to care for this girl who will not renounce her sinful ways nor accept Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. You know what happens? I'm waking up in the night with these perverted sexual thoughts trying to hit my head. What is this? One after another. And I was up all night laying on the floor in prayer, claiming the blood of Christ and the word of God. I'm throwing darts of scripture because the devil's throwing darts of temptation at me. And I asked, what has come into my home that's allowing these perversions to hit me? Be careful. Not by a thought will I yield to that type of temptation, but it was a war. You got it? Look at this. He could, okay, pure food, clean thoughts, physical exercise, place them on the list of children in whom was no blemish. So wine is a mocker, strong drink is raging, whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. And I never knew that the Bible described my life so well as I was drinking to excess. Who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has contentions? Who has babbling? Who has wounds without cause? Who has redness of eyes? They that tarry long at the wine, they that go to seek mixed wine, look not thou upon the wine when it's red and when it gives its color in the cup, when it moves itself aright, that's fermentation. It's moving, okay? It's fermented. What will it do? This was me. My mother would come in and look for my contact lenses. She says, she'd come in trying to find them. They're in my hair. They're on the ground. Then she looks and I vomited on the floor. The car's wrecked outside. I don't even know it. One time I drove an MG midget home from San Francisco. First of all, I was so drunk. I went there for my master's in nutrition, by the way. I leave the bar. I'm so drunk, I can't find the car. I wandered for an hour, finally found the car, drove home, and when I woke up the next day, four tires were flat. I don't know what I did. I don't know what I hit. I don't even know how I made it home. At last, it bites like a serpent. It stings like an adder. Thine eyes shall behold strange women. Oh, did that happen time and time again? Married or not, it doesn't matter. When you compromise the clarity of your mind by becoming inebriated or intoxication, you will lose your morals and your judgment. Thine eyes shall behold strange women. Your heart shall utter perverse things. You shall be as he that lies down in the midst of a sea, or he that lies at the top of the mast. So you're up at the top of the mast in the ocean. You're lying in the sea. It's rocking. See, when I drink so much, the room would spin. And I knew every time the room started spinning, I was going to vomit. He describes it perfectly. And then I said, I'll never drink again. No, I'm done. What does the Bible say? They've stricken me. You shall say I felt it not. I'd wake up with bloody knuckles. I'd wake up not even knowing what I did the night before. You rip the crowbar out of a guy's hands. You're punching a guy in the face. Look at your hand. I don't even remember the fight. I got kicked one night at a bar in the face, cracked my face here and here by bikers. They have stricken me, you say, and I was not sick. They beat me, I felt it not. When shall I awake? I will seek it yet again. And I did. Drink, 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 to God miraculously delivered me from alcohol. Alcoholism is not a destination, but a progression. A long road of deterioration in which life continually worsens. So Daniel said, no wine. I don't care if it comes from Nebuchadnezzar's table. This is the best that Babylon has to offer. The best food, the best drink. It's from the king's table. I don't want any alcohol. What about the meat? Why did he refuse it? One, could have been unclean. The Bible, he was familiar with the Pentateuch and the Torah, and the swine, though he divide the hoof, he cloven-footed, yet he choose not to cut. It's unclean to you, so you don't want to eat the pig or the pepperoni or the sausage and the ham on the pizzas, right? The Bible says in Leviticus, nor touch its dead carcass. I had a guy who worked in a meatpacking plant just from handling the meat. He'd get an infection and a red line running up his arm, and you have to go on antibiotics for 10 days. The Bible and Daniel must have known, don't eat the fat, don't eat the blood. Right? Because he was familiar with the books of the Old Testament. Leviticus, we're in the first five books. Do not eat the fat of cattle, sheep, or goats. Now, those are clean animals. Notice, it's not the swine. So you're not to eat the fat of clean animals, and never are you to take the blood, because the life is in the blood. That means the prions. That means the RNA, DNA particles of leukemia. It's all in the blood. So blood, fat, E. coli, prions, would I refuse today? See, God had dietary law. But look at this for us living today, modern Israel. This is amazing. I don't know how anybody could eat beef after reading this. Altogether, the USDA programs test about 40,000 cows a year for mad cow, a tiny fraction of the millions that are slaughtered or otherwise die each year. That's less than 0.1% of the cattle herd. So nobody's checking the quality of your meat, but it's infected with mad cow disease. Isn't that a cool picture? So those who eat flesh are but eating grains and vegetables secondhand. For the animal receives from these things the nutrition that produces growth, the life I love this sentence, one of my favorite in the spirit of prophecy. The life that was in the grains and vegetables passes into the eater. Vitamins, minerals, nutrition, enzymes, biophotons. We receive it by eating the flesh of the animal. How much better to get it direct by eating the food that God has provided for our use? Another reason why Daniel refused, possibly, I believe it's true. From what I've done in research, even at Ralph's house, as soon as I arrived, I read a book by Henry Fierrobin on the book of Daniel, taking it verse by verse. And he was saying that the meat that was on Nebuchadnezzar's table was, they were always offered to idols. Okay? It was a blessing, as it were, to the meat. The meat's blessed. But a portion having been offered to idols, the food from the king's table was consecrated to idolatry, and one, this is the important part, one partaking of it would be regarded as offering homage to the gods of Babylon. In such homage, loyalty to Jehovah forbade Daniel and his companions to join. Even a mere pretense of eating the food or drinking the wine would be a denial of their faith. To do this would be to array themselves with heathenism and to dishonor the principles of the law of God. See, Daniel says, I'm not bowing down to your gods of Babylon, and I will not bow down to any other god but the true God. And even Paul wrote in Philippians, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus, contrary to the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and who mind earthly things. So he wouldn't compromise. But what's happening today is we treat the God of our belly and we feed the God of our belly more than we feed our minds with the word of God from the true God, the living God. I said, you know, we should have signs on our refrigerators that say, do you open your refrigerator more often than you open the Bible? Who's your God? Now, what I want to propose today, as I brought to you these little snippets of end time events when I began this presentation, this is more than just a story about a diet test. It's a test of character. What I want us to do now is really focus on Daniel's character, not just that he didn't eat the meat or the drink. At the very onset of their career, there came to them a decisive test of character. It was provided that they should eat of the food and drink of the wine that came from the king's table. We know the story, prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days. Let them give us pulse to eat and water to drink. Then let our countenances, or in the New King James said appearances, to be looked upon thee and the countenance of the children of the portion of the king's meat that eat the portion of the king's meat, and as you see, deal with your servant. Now that's so heavy. I love this. You know what that's saying? You go eat at McDonald's and Burger King, and I'm going to go eat out of the garden, and in 10 days we'll come back together and we'll take a look at ourselves. That's what that's saying. And so Bella Vita is a 10-day program. In 10 days, I begin to see light in their faces. There's a change in their complexion. There's a glow of light, not only, but rosy cheeks from the increased circulation. With the cholesterol out, the fat out, the oils are out. We're just giving them good, wholesome food, herbs, exercise, fresh air, sunshine. And I want to say something profound, because if you follow us through this weekend, this is what I've learned and I promote, that the goal of any natural healing program, the goal of our wellness center is blood purification. Did you hear me? So you're cleansed by the blood of Christ, and you need to cleanse your blood. And I'm going to show you some exciting scriptures and illustrations within the Bible that the Lord showed me that blew me away in regards of blood cleansing. Okay? Blood cleansing. This is your goal for healing. I'll prove it from the Bible and the spirit of prophecy. So Daniel chose a cleansing diet, right? And his appearances, or their countenance, appeared fair. These are my five kids. Once I was going to Hawaii, four of them were born. The fifth one wasn't, or three of them. I can't quite remember. But we were going on a 747, and we're walking down the aisle. And I heard somebody say, "Look at those children's faces. Beautiful skin. They've been plant eaters from birth, other than mother's milk. I raised them right. No animal foods, no dairy products. Got the refined sugars out of the diet." Okay, it was an animal-free, vegan-type diet. So their skin, they didn't have the blemishes. Isn't that beautiful? And then on the 747, as we're flying to Hawaii, when they used to serve the meals, you know, the stewardess is walking down with the meal tray and she says, "Vegan meals for Vierra? Vegan meals for Vierra?" And I heard someone say, "It's those children." What a perfect witness. And I went on and was witnessing to people around us that were interested why Daniel couldn't eat the fruity cookie. Because there was something in it that could affect the clarity of his mind. So, let's look at this more than just a diet test. Let's study the character of Daniel. Holy and without blemish. Let's look at this. One, he's skillful in wisdom, cunning in knowledge and science, correct? Integrity of character by winning favor and love and respect from what? The prince of the eunuch, the chief eunuch in charge of him, Ashpenaz. He was a man of steel. He was true to principle. He was strong in faith. He resisted temptation. He would not compromise with idolatrous practices of the heathen. He was an illustrious example of what men may become who unite with God's wisdom and power. He served the true God. We know those further stories or later stories in the book of Daniel where he's praying three times unto his God. His friends wouldn't bow down to the image, right? Physically, mentally, and spiritually, they were superior. He honored and obeyed God at the loss of all things. This is important. He honored and obeyed God at the loss of all things, and God honored them. So God always honors the right. The most promising youth from all the land subdued by the great conqueror had been gathered at Babylon, yet amid them all, the Hebrew captives were without a rival. Now look at the description of them. The erect form, the firm elastic step, the fair countenance, the undimmed senses, the untainted breath. No putrefaction in the large intestine from rotting, decaying animal flesh. All were so many certificates of good habits, insignia of the nobility which nature honors those who are obedient to her laws. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that beautiful? Don't you want to be like him? Okay, then. He was obedient to God's commandments and his health laws. Was he not? He wouldn't defile himself. He drank water. He ate pure plant produce with no GMOs, organic. Doesn't say if it was cooked, boiled, fried, or baked or raw. But he ate a plant-based diet. Some will say legumes and grains and vegetables. But if we look at God's Ten Commandments, which he was familiar with, correct? He knew the Torah. He knew the Pentateuch. And also, I believe, as you look at Leviticus and you look at Genesis, you find God had health laws. Exercise, water, fresh air, rest. So I'm looking at what must Danny do as he prepares for the crisis ahead? I think we need to be obedient to these. Would you agree? Okay. Now I want to challenge you with your own theology. You ready for this? Nobody leave. Okay. It is just as much a sin to violate the laws of our being as to break one of the Ten Commandments. For we cannot do either without breaking God's law. They're both God's law. If you don't drink water, you're going to die. If you commit adultery, the wages of sin is death. But we have a Savior, Jesus Christ, the righteous. For we cannot do either without breaking God's law. We cannot love the Lord with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength while we're loving our appetites, our tastes, a great deal better than we love the Lord. How do you feel about that statement? Is it too strong? Should have I edited it and left it out? I mean, we're living in the last days. Come on. I'm addressing the God of our bellies. Okay, now let's go. You ready? From the Bible. For whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he's guilty of all. Would you agree? For he that said, do not commit adultery, said also, do not kill. Now, if you commit no adultery, yet if you kill, you are become a transgressor of the law. So speak ye, and so do, as they that shall be judged. I love this, by the law of liberty. You see, by being faithful to my wife, by honoring my parents, by, you know, preserving life and not killing, it's a law of liberty. See, there's no law against love, joy, and peace, but there's a law against hatred, killing, and adultery. So it's a law of liberty. It's a law of freedom from sin. So you agree with that? Okay, let's move on. So what if we exercise, but we don't eat right? What if we get plenty of sunshine, but we go to bed too late and don't drink enough water? Are we transgressing the laws of health? Sickness is the result of violating nature's laws. Our first duty, one which we owe to God, to ourselves, to our fellow men, is to obey the laws of God, and these include the laws of health. Wow. That's heavy. So I'm challenging you today. If you're not being obedient to the laws of health, it's time. It's high time. We are facing a crisis of stupendous proportions, and we must have an experience that we don't already have. It's time. This may be your last opportunity to hear a message like this. This may be it. Never again. Educate away from drugs, use them less and less, and depend more on hygienic agencies, then nature will respond to God's physicians. Isn't that beautiful? Pure air, pure water, proper exercise, and a clear conscience. See, God wants to dwell in the holy place of your mind. That's where the Lord wants to be. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Daniel fed his body temple with plant-based food. He knew the meat was stimulating. He knew there was blood, there was fat. Prions, GMOs, mad cow disease. He wouldn't take the alcohol because it would kill brain cells. Nothing comes into my mind or my body that will affect my mind. What about us? Shemitahs, blood moons, the Pope coming. I mean, for Adventists, the Pope's coming to address Congress. And he's pushing Sunday rest with the family rest movement and getting back to the commandments of God. And I'm not done with this presentation. Just follow me. So watch, the most holy place. Whoops. Your mind. God wants to dwell here. We need to be fortified with the word of God. We need to become one with Christ Jesus. Our body is the dwelling place, the tabernacle that Jesus wants to live in. Is that heavy? Now look at this statement. Here's my one of my pet peeves. We need to get busy. I call it Adventist Mass. You come to church once a week, but we don't do anything else. You gotta organize for service now. You gotta get busy. If you truly believe your doctrine, you truly believe your religion, then you're on this earth to vindicate God's character, to proclaim the three angels' message, and to serve other people. You have been called to service. Now watch. The Church of Christ is organized for service. Its watchword is ministry. Its members are soldiers. They should not only give instruction and write principles, but educate their hearers to, I don't know why I lost some of my words, to follow these principles. So I'm not only to tell you about the principles, I'm trying to encourage you to go out and do the principles. This is what my wife and I, just to motivate you, have been doing for many years. We try to educate the people. We travel. We're going to Canada next. She's doing a week at SoCal camp meeting. Then we go to England. And we get tired. But we're in the last remnant of time. She's out there. And you know what she's doing as I walked up here to speak? Give it to them. Wake them up. Give it to them. And I said, quit saying that. Give it to them. I said, no, come on, stop. And I finally looked at her, and she's going in cradle roll. I said, give it to him. So we put on health and healing expos. This year I have Dr. Richard Shear, Dr. Tim Riesenberger, Ivor Myers, Christian Berdol. So we put on events. We rent the whole grape festival. We do Bible studies on health and the gospel. We have a lending library now where we've taken messages on health and we knock on doors in the neighborhood. Now, maybe it's a little tough sometimes to go and, would you like Bible studies? I'm from the whatever church you're from. But we knock on doors and we introduce ourselves that we're doing community outreach to help people that may be suffering with sickness and disease. And do you have any needs? Oh yeah, my wife's got cancer. I got diabetes. And we lend a DVD. And we say, we'll be back in a week to pick it up. Oh, thanks. So you're educating them with health. It's an entering wedge. And we go back in a week and we gather up the videos and we say, would you like another one? So you're building a rapport. You're helping them with their need. You may help them reverse their sickness, their diabetes. We also will do health lectures as we're doing here in your church and cooking classes to educate people. And then I wrote 5 books, little books that you can hand out cheaply. You're on a plane, you're in the grocery store and you want to tell somebody about health because you overhear them saying they got cancer. You can hand them a little book. You can have them for 50 cents each, okay? I don't care. Get them out. Try it. If you're afraid to say anything to somebody or to share the health message in the gospel, break through the fear. It's time to break through the fear and just say, would you like a book? And when they take it, you feel better. And you go, wow, that's kind of fun. And imagine the day you get the phone call that the woman's sitting in a church because you gave them a little book on a plane. That's the reward. We also have a lifestyle center where we bring people in and we help them that are sick. We also do a children's program. She's ready to publish a book called Eat More Rainbows with more mothers organized for raw eating to go out and to try to educate the children in proper eating techniques. Social media. I'm throwing up free DVDs constantly now. There's like 103,000 subscribers to educate the masses, no charge, on health. Facebook, natural healing, raw food classes, okay? Advertising upcoming events, using social media in a very positive way rather than doing it in a negative way. How about a school where you train medical missionary workers in Bible studies, in evangelism? We feed the poor. We pass out materials. We take them door to door. How about trade show booths for conventions where you set up a booth with all your material and you start educating people with all of this? How about foods, cooking classes, showing him God's original diet, pointing him to the healing properties of plant-based foods, showing him that there's phytochemicals in these foods, that when God gave the original diet in the Garden of Eden, it was the best diet for us. And it happens to be what Daniel chose, isn't it? What did he choose? He chose plant-based foods. He wanted his mind clear. He wouldn't put any alcohol into his system. See, it gets interesting to me. And I see this even at our church, that we're preaching the end time message and we all sit there and say time's short, but then when it's going door to door or getting out and doing something in the community or trying to reach the public, nobody wants the help. Can I get an amen? What do you think we should be doing? Should we be helping or should we not? Shouldn't we be active? Taking this message, so we show about antioxidants. Look at this. It is a duty to know how to preserve the body in the very best condition of health. And it is a sacred duty to live up to the light which God has graciously given. If we close our eyes to the light for fear we shall see our wrongs, which we are unwilling to forsake, our sins are not lessened but increased. If light is turned from one case, it will be disregarded in another. And let me just say this to you. Can you bear with me? I mean, my heart is here for you. I know the signs of the times. I know what it means to pound the streets. I know what it means to fly internationally. I know what it means to be so exhausted and the phone rings and somebody else has cancer. But my heart is here for you. Because when I was just in Fiji, the co-speaker there was Chris Hudson, the Forerunner Chronicles, Forerunner 777. And he would speak and I would speak. And one thing I saw in common, and you know what it was? It was the message. And you know what that message was? Repent. For the kingdom of heaven is at hand. John the Baptist spoke it. Jesus Christ spoke it. And in Revelation chapter 3, to the church of Laodicea, because I love you, I rebuke and chasten you, be zealous and repent. And what that means is if we've violated God's laws, then we need to tell him we're sorry. Because Jesus is coming. Do you really believe it? Well, I do. Okay. As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance, but as he which has called you is holy, be you holy in all matter of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy for I am holy. Do you know where those words in Peter were taken from? Remember Daniel, sanctified? He was sanctified. Holy and without blemish. God's calling for that condition in the church in the last days. Where was this taken from? Leviticus 44, 46, 47, but 44, the dietary laws, the clean and the unclean. Very interesting, isn't it? For I am the Lord your God. Ye shall therefore sanctify yourselves, and ye shall be holy, for I am holy. This is the law of the beast and of the fowl, of every living creature that moves in the waters, and every creature that creeps upon the earth, to make a difference between the clean and the unclean, between the beasts that can be eaten and the beasts that shall not be eaten. So we got a problem with appetite. I like to eat. How about you? I like good food. I like eating. But I watch what I put into my body because I don't want anything to affect the clarity of my mind or my disposition. Or to have a sour stomach, to have a cranky attitude. And I want to get in the best condition. You know, I do a presentation here. I don't know if I'm going to do it here, but it's called Health Reform in the Christian Race. And Paul likens the Christian race in 1 Corinthians chapter 9 to the Greek Olympic Games, right? And he talks about the man who strives for the mastery is temperate in all things. And he's likening the conditioning of God's chosen people in the end of time to the Greek Olympic athletes that were the top athletes. And the message goes into temperance and strict training and guarding your appetite and exercising. He's trying to tell God's people in the last days, we need to have victory over these areas of our life and let nothing, here's the biggie, let nothing that we're taking into our body that's wrong affect our mind, but more so, I don't want my stomach to control my head. The fleshly carnal nature to tell me what to do rather than my mind sanctified by the Holy Spirit. Does that make sense? True temperance teaches us to dispense entirely with everything hurtful, and to use judiciously that which is healthful. There are few who realize, as they should, how much their habits of diet have to do with their health, their character. Did you see that? Their health, their character, their usefulness in the world, and their eternal destiny. The appetite should ever be in subjection to the moral and intellectual powers. The body should be servant to the mind and not the mind to the body. That was Paul's message in 1 Corinthians 9. I bring my body under subjection, lest what I've preached to others, I find myself a castaway. So God wants men to labor in his cause who have hearts as true as steel and who will stand steadfast in integrity, undaunted by circumstances, amid trial and gloom. They are just what they were when their prospects were brightened by hope and when their outward surroundings were all that they could desire. Among the children of Israel who were carried captive to Babylon at the beginning of the 70-year captivity were Christian patriots, men who were as true as steel to principle. Isn't that beautiful? True as steel. Are you true as steel to principle? You see the story here? Do you think it's making, does it make sense? The condition that God's calling us to be in these last days. I'm saved by grace. I got that. But the balance is that the good works will be the evidence of my saving relationship with Jesus Christ through faith. I'm saved by grace alone, I will say. Through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast, but we are his workmanship, created unto Christ Jesus unto good works. So because of my saving relationship with Christ, I do the works of Christ. There's obedience. I don't obey to be saved. I obey because I'm connected to Christ Jesus. So always remember, grace doesn't nullify the law. I can be saved by grace and I'm out there killing people and robbing and stealing. No. And I like to say it this way. One night I was up all night studying the word grace and I found the best definition. Unmerited favor is a good one. Jesus merited it. I never did. It's a free gift. I can't earn it. But I was studying and I was praying for God to show me more. And you know, I looked into Strong's Concordance. And you know what the definition was? Power. The divine influence in the heart that's reflected in the life. Wow. So that told me faith works. It's the power of God unto salvation. And the just shall live by faith. But isn't that beautiful? And one lady said to me, but Danny, I don't understand. Break it down to one word. And I said, power. It's the power of God, his spiritual energy, his turbo boost for you who's in a fallen human nature. You can't do the will of God, but you certainly can through his divine power. See? So I can be a partaker of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that's in the world through lust. Your appetite may be your lust, but the promise of the gospel is the power to obey. Isn't that beautiful? So who's with me today? The divine influence upon the heart that's reflected in the life. And Jeff, get a book called Christ Object Lesson. Somebody will give you a copy here, or ask Ralph, the pastor. And there's a chapter in there on grace that's the best I've ever read. And it goes into the parable likened to leaven. So something totally from without, the yeast, has to be applied to the meal before it expands and there's a transformation. That's the grace of God applied within our hearts. We're changed. Isn't that beautiful? That's beautiful, all right? So I just want to ask, and I'm going to end now. There's actually a lot more, but we've kind of gone a little long today, but I just want to make an appeal that if there's one person here that wants to come up front and kneel with me for a special prayer, and the prayer can be, I need victory over my appetite. I need the grace of God in my life. I need to repent because I have not obeyed your health laws. Maybe I'm just coming to church and I'm sitting on a pew, but I don't do anything. Maybe I need God's divine power today. Is there anyone who wants to come? You can come right up here. It's okay with this. Don't worry about this. Anybody here? I mean, this, God's calling Christian patriots. God is calling soldiers. If you've heard his voice today, if you've heard his spirit today, and you want to join me for a special prayer for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on us and for God to cleanse us from all our failure and to be fortified for what's coming. If you hear the seriousness of the message today, please come forward. And as I said, this may be your last opportunity. And this is what my wife meant when she said hit them hard. It's my love in my heart. Really, it is. It's my love in my heart. I know what's coming. I see how close it is. And if I don't blow the trumpet, your blood will be required of the watchman's hands. I didn't say it, and I knew it. You hearing me? And I really want to persuade you to be working in your community. You know, you're called in these last days to share the good news of the gospel. You've been called to service, and we got to do that. We can't just sit there and say, yeah, I knew all this, but I never passed out a tract. I never knocked on a door. You'd be surprised the fulfillment of the joy when you reach a heart, or maybe you lead them to Bible studies with Pastor Ralph at the church here, you know? But we got to get busy. There's a battle coming. There's a war on. And it's, are you listening? It's later than you think. Whether these evangelical speakers are right, whether September is a time where everything changes in our nation. But it's getting so close. I pray now that God holds back the winds of strife till his servants are sealed in their forts. Including me. Anybody else want to come forward for a special prayer? Let us kneel and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we know you love us more than we can imagine. And you say, because I love you, I rebuke and chasten you. Be zealous and repent. And you tell us through Jesus Christ in the book of Revelation, that was revealed unto John, that your church in the last day has no need. They think they're rich and increase with goods. They have need of nothing. But you send a message that startles them. And you call them to repentance because their spiritual condition is not what they think. Father, we live in that church era. We identify with that seventh church. But I pray today that we don't have that condition of that seventh church. That you bless us all right now, Father, and the people that have come forward, forgive them for their sins. Forgive them for their transgressions of your health principles, and give them victory over their own habits and practices that may be out of harmony with your word. Whatever their idol is, whatever their sin is, Father, that they're struggling with this day, they've come forward because they need help. And I ask that you will empower them with your Holy Spirit, that you'll give them the grace of God and that spiritual turbo boost to overcome, Father. Take away their sugar cravings, their pornography, Father, their alcohol, their tobacco, their pork eating, whatever it may be, Father, their gluttony, the television, Netflix, movies. I'm not studying the Bible. I know these signs are here. And we feel helpless. We feel like we're powerless. But I pray for a baptism of the Holy Spirit over these people here today. And Father, even those in the pew. Father, I pray you bring us to repentance because the goodness of God leads us there. That you will fulfill your word that you dealt to every man a measure of faith. That your gift of grace is given unto us. That Jesus died for our sins and the Holy Spirit will come as our comforter and sanctify us completely. So I pray for a miracle today in this house. A miracle, Father, that a first love experience will return to the hearts of each person here. And this community, this church, will never be the same. Father, it's time. It's high time. All the signs are coming. And Father, may this day be recorded in the books of heaven that people have given their hearts to you afresh. And may you honor that, Father, with the presence of your Holy Spirit. Possess them with the Holy Ghost and pour out the latter rain upon them is my prayer in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.